Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Tonight I want to talk to you about all kinds of prayer. It's the title of tonight's message. It's actually part number one. If you want to get a hold of part number two, you're going to have to come Wednesday night. Ha ha, got you to come to church two times in 1 week. Praise the Lord. But this is part number one, just because simply when you talk about a subject like prayer, there is so much to talk about when it comes to prayer. And for such a simple thing like prayer, little word, prayer, there's quite a bit in the word that we could talk about. And I want to talk to you tonight about all kinds of prayer. Ephesians chapter 6, if you will, turn there with me in your Bible, Ephesians chapter 6. Right after the Apostle Paul starts talking about our struggle, it's not against flesh and blood, but against powers, principalities, right? Powers of darkness, all kinds of things in the spirit realm that we're fighting. We're not fighting flesh and blood. This is not a physical fight. This is a spiritual fight. And he says we need to put on the whole armor when we take our stand in the evil day. And we've got to do all this stand. And he starts talking about the armor that we wear, starts talking about different things like righteousness and salvation, that we've got the word of God at our disposal. And at the end of his statements about the armor and the battle that we're facing each and every day, take a look at what he says in Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verse number 18. After he says take up the word and your faith and all that kind of stuff, verse number 18, this is what he says. He says, praying always with all prayer. Everybody say all prayer. Some translations actually say all kinds of prayer or every kind of prayer. And supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Now, this is part number one, like I said, and part number two, I think I'm going to get into that word supplication a little bit because that's kind of a Christianese word. We don't usually use that word outside, but basically it means your requests, what you're asking God for. I like that, though, that it says pray always with all kinds of prayer. At all times and on every occasion, the New Living Translation says. In fact, the NIV says on all occasions and with all kinds of prayers and requests. And Darby translated it, and he said in all seasons. See, whatever season of life that you may be in, maybe you are in a season of joy, a season of strength. Don't let up on your prayers. Maybe you're in a season of pain or trial, suffering. I know you're probably praying already, but don't give up the fight. Maybe you're just in a season of plateau, and it feels like God's not there. And you're kind of wondering, what's going on? See, it's time to continue. It's time to strengthen yourself and to pray with all kinds of prayers. There's different kinds of prayers you'll find in the Bible. Long prayers, short prayers, very eloquent prayers. Prayers that are very theologically rich. There are prayers that are encouraging and strengthening. And then little bitty prayers that you'll find in the Bible that are no less powerful or effective. I want to talk to you about some of these types of prayers because the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 17, that we should pray without ceasing. Three little words that you should put to memory. Pray without ceasing. Now, sometimes we think, well, wait a second. Pray without ceasing, Pastor. I don't get it. Because if all I did was pray, I would never eat, I would never sleep, I would never go to work. All I would do is pray. In fact, I wouldn't be here right now because I'm listening and I'm attending church, so I can't be praying while I'm listening, can I? See, that's not the idea. The idea is on every occasion that you have, when you get that opportunity, that you take the opportunity to lift it up to the Lord in prayer. Now, obviously, throughout your day, you're going to have different times. Sometimes in the morning, you're going to have a big space of time that you're going to be able to get up. And maybe if you don't have that right now, you might need to wake up a little earlier. Okay, I'm preaching to the choir right now, or to the preacher, I should say. You might need to get up a little bit earlier. Might need to wake up so that you can spend some extra time in prayer and start your day off right. But guess what? What happens if the alarm, you know, doesn't go off? Or what happens if you end up getting up late because you maybe pushed the alarm a couple too many times rolling over in your sleep? Well, you can still pray. You can still pray in the shower. You can still pray in the car. You can still pray as you go. Take some time at lunch during your break at work to pray. Take some time on your way home to pray. Take some time with your family at night to pray. See, every occasion, anytime something comes up, and we'll look at this as we go through the word tonight, you should be able to just take some time and lift it up to God. Whether that's a quick little, hey, God, I need help, or whether that's a long, God, I just bring you my entire day, God. I got all these things ahead. Let's list them out, Lord. Let's talk about them, God. Let's talk about how I feel, God. Let's talk about how you feel, God. Let's talk about it all. But we need to pray without ceasing. It means we need to continually keep the lines of communication open with God. Are you listening tonight? So I want to talk about all kinds of prayer. First one that we can see right there in Ephesians 6:18 is this, is prayer in the Spirit. Prayer in the Spirit. Because if I could submit something to your thinking tonight, every prayer that we pray should be prayed in the Spirit. Now, that doesn't make sense to some of our minds because we've been taught that prayer in the Spirit is speaking in tongues. I would say, yes, it certainly is. If you're going to speak in tongues, you have to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You have to have that gift of language that's been given to you to be able to pray in the Spirit or in an unknown tongue. But did you know that not every time in the Bible, if you read it, does prayer in the Spirit specifically mean praying in tongues? So what does it mean? Well, let me rewind your thinking. Maybe you've been around here for a while. Pastor Deborah had a definition. I'm going to put it up for you on the overhead, okay? Prayer in the Spirit is this. Prayer in the Spirit is fervent, faith-filled, word-based communication with God. That means that no matter what type of prayer you are using, what type of prayer matches the situation, how long or how short your prayer should be fervent. What does that mean? It means you should be into it. Half-hearted does not work with God. You'll run up empty and you will not make it to your destination on half-hearted. So you have to be fervent. You have to be wholehearted. You have to really want it with God. But not only that, it has to be faith-filled. See, you've got to believe that God is, number one, you're talking to an invisible God, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So if you're expecting something from God, then you will receive those things, right? He who believes shall receive those things that he's asked. But if you don't really believe, you should expect to receive nothing. James actually says you're like a wave tossed to and fro, and you shouldn't expect to get anything from God. So you have to have fervent, faith-filled, and then look at this, word-based. It has to be something that you can see that lines up with the will and way of God. Has to line up with the word of God. And when you pray your prayers, if you know your word, you will find the word coming out in your prayers. So it's word-based. In other words, if I can find it in here, then I can pray it and receive it in my life. 1 John chapter 5 says that we know that we have what we ask of him if we ask according to his will, that he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have the things that we've asked of him. So anything you ask, as long as it goes along with the will of God, you can have it. So that's why word-based is so important. And then finally, communication with God. And we'll talk about that, like I said, as we go through. See, in the Expanded Bible, it says pray in or in dependence on the Spirit. There's something that happens when you are praying, and whether you're praying in your known language and an unknown language, whether you're praying for a situation, whether you're asking God for something, whatever type of prayer you're employing, but there's something that happens when you realize and recognize that you cannot do this on your own. And when you start to tap into the power of the Holy Spirit and you say, Spirit, I don't know how to pray as I ought to. I come up short. I can bring my request, but Spirit, unless you bring that request up to the throne of God, it's not going anywhere. It's going to bounce off the roof and come back down. I can ask God for wisdom, but Spirit, unless you enlighten my heart, I'm not going to understand it. I will never get the revelation that I need for my life. See, that's why we need to be praying in the Spirit. It needs to be fervent, faith-filled, word-based communication with God. Let's take a look at it. You're there in Ephesians. Turn back towards the end of your Bible to the book of James, right past Hebrews, where we've been on Sunday mornings. You'll find the book of James right after that. Keep going. Hebrews, James chapter number 5 gives us a great example. The prophet Elijah. James chapter 5, verse number 16, very familiar verse when it comes to prayer. It says this, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. So we see a couple of things going on here. He says, confess your sin, okay? And he says, pray for one another that you may be healed. There is a prayer that we can pray. We can ask for healing. Now look at what he says. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. I remember in Bible college, we used to say that in the old King James Version to make ourselves feel like we were cool, right? The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much, right? And we would say it 5 times fast and try not to get tongue-tied. But the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now see, you say, well, wait a second. If I mess up, does that mean God doesn't hear my prayers? Well, yeah, certainly the psalmist says that if I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have heard my cry. But the moment that you give your heart and life to Jesus, Now you are imputed righteousness. Now you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So if you mess up, repent, confess it before the Lord, right? That's why he says, confess your trespasses, and then pray. So confess it, bring it to God. God, I messed up, but Lord, I ask that you forgive me. God, I recognize that I'm wrong. I repent. I turn back to you and your will and your way. And now you can go before the Father. The Bible says God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That means that you are once again in that righteous position. So now, in that position, as you bring your request to God, see, if it was based on you and how good you were, you would never get an answered prayer. But it's not based on you. It's based on him. God is saying, I've given you my righteousness. Now you can approach the throne. Now you can walk into the very throne room of God. You can find mercy. You can find grace to help in a time of need. And so you've got to be into it. You've got to want it. You've got to come and you've got to ask. Even though God knows you what you have need of before you ask, he still wants you to ask. Isn't that amazing? You know why that is? Because God wants relationship. He doesn't want to be this impersonal force that just throws stuff at you in your way and you forget about God along the way because you have everything you need of because God already knows. So, hey, praise God. Thanks, God. See you later. No, you won't. God knows what we need. He knows we have need of relationship with him. And that's why he tells us, ask. Come, I want you. God doesn't want just robots out there doing whatever. God wants partnership. God wants relationship. God wants to work and move on the earth in the church and in our prayers. We can move the hand of God on the earth because God wants to move in the church. But you got to want it. You got to go after it. Now, he gives us an example in the next two verses. Take a look at it with me. It says, Elijah was a man. Everybody say a man. Amen. Now, remember, Elijah was also a prophet, right? But in this example, he doesn't point out that he was a prophet. Why? Because that doesn't matter. You could be a prophet, you could be a priest, you could be a king, you could be a pauper, you could be a worker, you could be a nobody. But even a nobody is somebody when it comes to this kingdom of God, right? In fact, the Bible says those that are least in the kingdom of God were greater than John the Baptist, who was greater than all the prophets before him. Wow. That means that it doesn't matter that Elijah was a prophet. His position as a prophet didn't make any bit of difference when it came to his prayers. He was a man with a nature like ours. You know you can find that Elijah messed up in the Bible. You can find attitudes expressed in his life, things that he did. Right here he is in a cave crying and weeping about Jezebel when he had just called down fire out of heaven on a sacrifice and slaughtered all of the prophets of Baal. And yet here he is sniveling because some queen says she's going to kill him. God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? Okay, listen, set this in order and start to do some things. But it says that he was a man with a nature like ours, so we know he had a sin nature. And because he was a prophet, didn't get him any better position with God. And he did what? Oh, there's only three people in the room. Let's try that again. He did what? Pray. How did he pray? Earnestly. He prayed fervently. He prayed passionately. He prayed unwaveringly. He prayed that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. I don't know about you, but when I think about the power that we have in prayer, I get excited. Is there a drought in the land today? In California, they're telling us there is a drought. Let's look at the next verse. Verse number 18. And he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. If you want to stop the drought, you can. But you got to want it, and you've got to ask, and you got to be fervent, and it's got to be faith-filled, and it's got to be word-based. Prayer in the Spirit, you can go after it. Church, we don't recognize and realize the power that we have. That if we can pray in the Spirit, what do you want? See, when you go before the King, it's not time to fall asleep. When you have entrance with the King of Glory, and you can ask him for whatever you want because you are his bride and you are beautiful in his eyes, and it delights him, it pleases him to give us richly all things to enjoy. What do you want from God? A couple of problems we don't know. See, I don't know what I want, God. Figure it out and then ask. You want a great marriage? Get to prayer. You want great kids? Get to prayer. You want a great business and be prosperous and successful in life? It's time to pray. Pray in the Spirit as the Spirit leads you. Fervent, faith-filled, word-based, communication with God. Bring it to the Lord and allow God to move in your life. Does anybody want to pray right now? Where's Reverend Teresa? Come up here, Reverend Teresa. Jason, can you hand me that mic? This is my brother Jason. We're going to pray. Stand up, get in a posture of prayer, and let's pray a fervent, faith-filled, word-based communication with God. Come on, this is not time to sleep. Lead us in a prayer.
Father God, thank you for your presence tonight, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord God, that you're here in our midst working, Father, on our hearts. We thank you, Father, that tonight your word is dwelling richly inside of us, Lord God, and that it's changing us and transforming us. We thank you for the power of your word, that it's living and powerful, that it's sharper than any two-edged sword, that it pierces to the division of sunder of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Father, and I ask that as your word goes forth tonight, Lord God, that it would penetrate deep within us, Father, and that when we exit this place tonight, that we would do so changed, that we would do so challenged, that we would be so transformed, Father, that we would be willing to take up, Lord God, that mantle of prayer and put it on, Lord God, and begin to open our mouth and declare your promises, begin to declare your plan, begin to declare your purposes, begin to declare our victory, Lord God, by the power that you've given us through the name of Jesus in our life. We thank you for the miraculous in our week, Father, the miraculous in our family, the miraculous in our workplaces, because we open our mouth and we declare your word, Father, effectively, Father God, powerfully, faith-filled in all that we do, Lord God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your promises. We thank you for the name of Jesus that is above every other name, Lord God. We thank you that all power on earth, Father, is in our hands because of the name of Jesus, Lord God, that no name is higher than the name of Jesus. And we thank you for change, faith-filled hearts tonight. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise. You can have a seat once again. All right. Sometimes fervency is expressed with volume, like you just heard. And sometimes fervency is expressed with intensity. What do I mean by that? You remember Hannah when she wanted a child? You remember that? Book of 1 Samuel. All she wanted was a child. She was barren. She went before the Lord, and she was so intense, so passionate before God. She was praying so hard that as she was praying, her mouth was moving, but no sound was coming out. She was just... The high priest thought she was drunk. That's in your Bible. Did you know that? And yet, it was her heart. And after she says, no, I'm not drunk. I'm just intense. I'm just passionate before the Lord. The high priest blesses her, and she goes off, and she has a child. See, our prayers work. Our prayers availeth much. Hallelujah. Prayer in the Spirit is number one. Second thing for tonight, all kinds of prayer. Second kind of prayer I want to take a look at is daily prayers. Daily prayers. You should be praying every day. I know we talked about this when we said pray without ceasing, but you know what? There is something to be said of our daily prayers. Now, I used to get down on daily prayers. I used to think, man, you can't script it. You can't have the same prayer every day. It has to be different. You got to change it every day. Problem is that life doesn't change that much from day to day. Is that true? I mean, I don't know about you, but there's certain routines that I go through. I wake up, I brush my teeth, I shower, I get dressed, I go downstairs, I eat breakfast, I go to work, I work, then I go home, then we have dinner together as a family. I mean, sometimes weeks can go by and there's not much variation. Is that true? And so it's hard sometimes for me to focus on a daily prayer. And yet I believe that God wants us to pray daily prayers. Not a script, not cold, dead, empty words, and not to be not led by the Spirit, that God can change it. But God can take the same topic of prayer, if you will, and God can apply it several different ways for each new day. There's a neat story when Solomon was talking about the different sacrifices. He said, as each day requires. Kind of a neat statement when you think about it, because even though we may be praying certain topics, as each day requires, God can apply those things to our life. Let's take a look at it in the book of Matthew now. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter number 6. Jesus is preaching his wonderful Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 6, he goes into this topic of prayer. I'm going to read verse number 9, and I'm going to read all the way through verse number 13. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 9, it says this, in this manner, therefore, pray. Now, I want you to notice something. Stop right there for a second. Look up at the overheads. In this manner, therefore, pray. Now, some have thought that that is the only words, that you have to repeat those words verbatim. I believe that because Jesus said in this manner, he was giving us a template. It's almost like a blank slate. Here's some things I want you to cover in your prayers. And you can pray this prayer in your daily prayers. If you don't know where to start, if you don't know what to do, if you get before God and you find yourself running on E, if you will, and there's nothing coming out, yes, you can be led by the Spirit. Yes, you can pray. Yes, you can do whatever. But if you find yourself just at a loss or you want to go over some topics in prayer, this prayer is pleasing to the Father, right? Because if you believe this, you can be faith-filled. You can be fervent about this. It's definitely word-based because it's from the mouth of Jesus. And look at what he says. In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. What's he doing? He's exalting the Father. He's lifting him up. He's praising him. He's hallowing him, right? God, you are holy. You are set apart, God. I'm exclusively yours, God. You're something special in my life, Lord. There's something different about you than anything else in my life. Let's take a look at the next verse, verse number 10. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, notice something. He just said your name. Now, verse 10, your kingdom, your will. See, those are three great prayers that you can pray each and every day. Your kingdom, God, not my kingdom, your kingdom. Your name, God, not my name, your name, God, be lifted up. May the name of Jesus go forth into the earth. May Jesus be lifted up. Your name be exalted among the nations. Your kingdom come, God, not the kingdom of darkness, not the kingdoms of this earth, not any other kingdom, not a man's kingdom, but your kingdom come, God. And your will be done. God, I pray that prayer of consecration, God, not my will, but yours be done, O Lord. Those are some great prayers that you can pray every day on earth as it is in heaven. Verse number 11, give us this day. Everybody say this day. This day. See, this is a daily prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. See, that's why it's so important to get the word in you each and every day, because God will apply it to your life. You will feed on that each and every day. You say, well, how much? Well, in the Old Testament, it said they gathered manna, right? They gathered that bread that came down from heaven. And he who gathered little didn't have too little, and he who gathered much didn't gather too much. So here's the point. Whatever you get, it'll be enough. You got time to pray? Got time to read one verse? That'll be enough for your day. You got lots of time to pray. You can get chapters. Hey, you won't have too much. It won't overwhelm you. God is enough for your life each and every day. Every day. And he says, and forgive us our debts. That's a good prayer to pray. Jesus told us in this manner, pray. We need to have a humble heart and recognize and realize, God, we still mess up in the flesh, but God, there's forgiveness with you. Blood of Jesus covers it. That doesn't excuse it. You still got to repent and turn around and stop it, work on it, allow the Spirit to change your hearts and your desires. But God, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. See, if you've been struggling with unforgiveness, bitterness, you've been holding on to hurts, God says in the same manner that you want to be forgiven, you should be forgiving. How did God forgive you? Completely, right? And he forgave you in Christ Jesus. Therefore, if you want to forgive somebody else, you've got to be in Christ and release it by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because why? God forgave me, therefore I can forgive them. My sin is under the blood of Jesus, therefore I put that offense and that hurt under the blood of Jesus. And you can move past the hurt and the pain and forgive. Now, that doesn't mean you have to be someone's doormat. Come on, somebody. But that does mean that you can release that bitterness. It doesn't have to hurt you anymore. If you want to work on that more, see Pastor Joel on Breaking Free. You can go online and take a look at that. But we have ways of helping you to intensely focus on that here at the church. And it's just a great way to break free of those hurts and those past pains and things through the power of the Holy Spirit. Hearing the word forgiveness, man, it's just great. It's just great. Okay? Forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. Verse 13, and do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Man, that's a great prayer to pray every day. God, deliver me. God, lead me away from temptation. Help me, God. I recognize and I realize that I need you. God, I can't do this on my own. Lord, if it was just up to me, I'd be falling in every pit, God, because I need your guidance. I need your leading, Lord. I need your wisdom and your vision. Help me, God. Deliver me. Lord, don't let the devil come around. Don't let him win the victory. God, deliver me from the evil one and the evil that's out there in the world and the evil that's on the inside of my flesh, God. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're back to exalting God, back to lifting him up, back to declaring who he is and stamping the amen, the so be it on the earth as it is in heaven in our lives. See, those are daily prayers. You can pray those topics each and every day over your life. You can take those things and apply them. And as you do, you might be praying for deliverance, and one day that deliverance is from the devil. Another day, that deliverance is from the person in the mirror. Come on, somebody. You might be praying for protection, and one day God protects you from chopping carrots and cutting your finger off. And another day, God protects you out there on the freeway from a crazy drunk driver. You could be praying, God, your will be done, and on one day that will is on the job, and another day that will is at the house. See, God will take as each day requires those daily prayers, as long as they're not empty words on a page, but it's something that's alive on the inside of you. You're praying in the Spirit, you're fervent, you're faith-filled, you're focused, and you're employing the Word of God in your life. And now, as you do that, God will apply it to each and every area of your life. See, there's a danger that our prayers become vain repetitions or empty words. In fact, Jesus said not to pray like that. If you back up just a couple of verses, Matthew chapter 6, verse 7 and 8, take a look at it with me. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. It's not about length, not about how good you sound. It's not about how many times you repeat it over and over and over and over and over again. That's not going to get the job done. Verse 8, therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. And then he goes on to say, in this manner, therefore, pray. Wow. God is asking us to pray daily prayers. Dr. Powell, would you come and just pray a simple prayer for us? Get in that posture of prayer once again. We're breaking this up because I don't want you to fall asleep on me. That's really what I'm doing. Just lead us in a prayer from the heart.
Amen. Father God, we're just grateful, Lord. I think we ask a lot, and you, certainly prayer is asking, but Lord, I want to ask for thanksgiving today, Lord, that you develop a heart of thanksgiving in all of us, Lord, that we remember everything you've done for us, Father, that if you do nothing else, you've already done enough. And so today, this congregation, Lord, we're just grateful, Father. We're grateful that you love San Bernardino. We're grateful that you placed us here. We're grateful that we have the opportunity to do so much, Father, with so little. We're just grateful tonight, Father. As Pastor Dan is teaching, I pray, Father, that the simplicity of prayer becomes a lifestyle for us in our car, in our homes, in what we do as we go to sleep and as we wake up, Father. May we be mindful that you are around us. May we be mindful that you are desirous to be with us. May we be mindful that you want to do something great in our lives and those around us, Father. So I pray today that this teaching becomes a lifestyle from this moment on, Lord, that we engage with you everywhere we go from this day forward. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. If you have a seat once again. Last thing for tonight that we're going to take a look at is this. Simple prayers. Aren't you glad that that one was included in the list? All kinds of prayers. There can be complex prayers. We can make it as complex as we want to, and you're still not going to school God. You know, you can get into the Word. You can get into theology, and there are theologically rich prayers that you will find in the Bible. But that is not a requirement of prayers. Okay? God says, you can come to me in simplicity. It's a simple gospel. It's a simple prayer. You know, sometimes we try and muddy the waters, don't we? I mean, I know that I have tried to so mysticize things with prayer when it comes to prayer. If you're not sweating, if you're not bleeding, if something's not, you know, if you don't feel something turning, come on now. There's been times where I have prayed for people, and it's just been the quickest little simple prayer. God, just heal them. And all of a sudden, they're screaming, whoa, 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 what happened? I don't know, you know, I'm just praying, you know, and yet they got healed. There's been times where I've had my daily prayers and I felt like nothing was going on, but God on the back end was working things out, and all of a sudden in a day, bang, everything turned around. And I'm the one going, whoa, 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 right? What happened? God says, you were praying. I said, I was. I was. Yes, praise the Lord. See, prayer is simple. You know what prayer is? talking with God. That's all it is. Just talk to God, just like you would talk to a friend. You don't have to include the these and the thous and the Almighty and the Father God and all that. Just talk to God. God, hello. God, good morning. God, good night. God, I love you. God, it's been a great day. Thank you. God, I need to ask you about something. God, I need wisdom. God, can you teach me about it? There have been times I've been reading the Bible and I said, I do not understand that. Lord, please teach me about that. And then I move on with my day. You know that God heard that prayer? And that later on, God will just drop a revelation on me. I'll be off in something else. And all of a sudden, it's like, you know what I mean? God just imparts, just drops some wisdom right on the end. Whoa, that's what that means. Man, you know, listen to a sermon on something else, spiritual warfare, and God's teaching me about prayer or something like that, you know? He'd be off on something else. But God heard that prayer, that simple little prayer that went up. You know, all of the disciples prayed simple prayers. Jesus prayed. Yeah, Jesus was up all night praying sometimes, but there's other times Jesus just said, Father, hey, glorify your name, right? God responds, thundering voice out of heaven, I've glorified it. My goodness, simple little prayer from Jesus just went up, bang, God answers right there. Paul prayed. John prayed. Many times the Apostle John prayed and he wasn't caught up in the Spirit and got the revelation, right? Think about that for a second. In fact, you'll find sections of your Bible that says John was going up to the temple at the hour of prayer. John prayed daily prayers before the Lord. And not every time did he pray was he caught up into the Spirit, up into heaven, seeing end times events and prophecies and Spirit of Christ and the lampstands and all that kind of stuff. No, that was a specific thing for a specific time. Most of the time, I would guarantee, it was just daily prayers, just connecting with the Lord, just talking to God. You can do that. You don't have to mystify it. It doesn't have to be some weird, kooky thing. It doesn't have to be hours, okay? Just has to be fervent, faith-filled, word-based communication with God. You just got to do it. Just got to open up the lines of communication and pray without ceasing. Never shut them off. See, we can find prayers that are well said and eloquent, like Nehemiah chapter 1. In fact, turn with me to the book of Nehemiah, your Bible, Old Testament. Okay? If you find the Psalms, keep going back past Job. You find Esther and then Nehemiah chapter 1. There's a great prayer. We don't have time to read it tonight. Eloquent prayer, rich in theology. My goodness, he talks about covenant. He talks about sin, confessing sin. It's just a great prayer that's contained for us in the Word of God. Now, we go from this wonderful prayer in Nehemiah chapter number 1, and then we find chapter number 2, right? Nehemiah 1, the problem is presented. He addresses the problem. He has this great, wonderful prayer. And now Nehemiah chapter number 2 comes along, and he's trying to figure out what to do because of the situation that's taking place. Nehemiah chapter 2, he's the cupbearer for the king. And so he goes in before the king, and he'd never been sad in the presence of the king before. Now, for those of you that don't understand why that's important, because if the cupbearer's job was to sip the wine before the king sipped the wine. What the cupbearer would do, he would take a little sip. Why would he do that? Because if the cupbearer falls over dead, king's not drinking that night, right? And he's going to go find out who the mole is in his organization is trying to kill him. Okay? So if the cupbearer comes in sad, that means that there may be a plot afoot and the cupbearer is a part of that plot. And he would be sad because he's handing the king his death and destruction. So the king sees him coming in sad. And the king looks at him, but the king has relationship with him. And he says, what's going on? This is none other than sadness of heart. Now, Nehemiah probably had a fear come upon him right then and there. Because the king, if he wanted to, could have ended his life right then and there. You're sad in my presence? You're trying to kill me? Take him away. But he doesn't. The king had relationship. This was a godly man. God had given him favor. Now, look at Nehemiah chapter number 2. Verse number 4, and we're going to read into the very first little line of verse number 5, okay? Then the king said to me, what do you request, right? He said, how can I be sad? How can I not be sad when the land of my fathers is torn down? All the walls of Jerusalem are torn down. So he says, what do you request? Now look at this. So I prayed to the God of heaven, okay? Verse number 5. Then the king said to me, Did you catch it? What do you request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king. I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king. I prayed to the God of heaven. How long was that prayer? Do you think he said, hold on, king, I'll be back in an hour. I've got to pray. I've got to do this right, okay? And I'm going to be underneath my bed, lying prostrate, talking for a long time. Will you still be here in an hour? You got things to do? You just eating dinner? Okay, I'll be back. No, he didn't say that at all. What did he do? You know what? I bet you he prayed. Help, Lord. See, sometimes we think that we have to mystify prayer. We think that we have to make it so hard and so long. And if you're not spitting sweat, if it's not a long time, we didn't pray. No, you prayed. Right there in the Word of God, you saw it. I prayed, then I said to the king. If all you have on the inside of you is Jesus, that will be more than enough. Anybody ever been at work and you heard something, you said, Jesus, right? The rest of your coworkers thought you were cussing. You were praying. Praise the Lord. See, you don't have to have a long prayer. You have to have fervent, faith-filled, word-based communication with God. Lord, give me favor as I go into this meeting. God, give me wisdom as I make a decision. Lord, I need help. That's all you got is help. It's all you need. God hears one-word prayers. Thank the Lord. I want to put a statement for you up on the overheads. It's kind of cool. If you're taking notes, you can write this down. God isn't looking for eloquence. He's looking for faith. God is not looking for eloquence. He's looking for faith. He'll take eloquence. Eloquence is great. He still hears eloquent prayers. You can find it in Nehemiah chapter number 1. But it's not a requirement of prayer. Faith is a requirement of prayer. You can pray a simple little prayer to God and be just as effective as if you were eloquent and very well spoken. But God doesn't require it. Last year, we had a children's camp, and I waited a year to tell you about it so that you would send your kids this year. Because we had something happen at camp. Don't worry, we didn't lose anyone, all right? But as we were taking our kids up, we got our kids ready, and you know, when you're taking your kids to the camp, they're little guys. You're making sure everything's all good, you know, making sure their backpacks are good, and they've got the right luggage, they've got the right sleeping bag and pillow and jammies and all that kind of stuff, right? You got enough money. 2 years in a row, we've forgotten their money. I don't know how we keep doing that, but we have it on us, but we forget to give it to them, you know, so I don't know what that's all about. Anyways, we're checking the weather, and the weather's saying rain. It's going to be a fun camp for the kids. They're in those canvas tent cabins, you know. So we thought, oh, man, they're going to be inside for a long time. And so, you know, we drive the kids up to camp, and we notice there's big clouds, big thunderheads up above the mountains. We're going, whoa, looks like they're going to get some rain. As we're driving past the bend going up towards the camp, Channel 7 News is out there with their camera aiming it at that big old cloud. How many of you know that's not very comforting when you're dropping your kids off at camp? And so we prayed a little prayer. Lord, help. We spoke to that cloud in the name of Jesus. You hold off. You will not dump on our kids. You will not ruin their camp. You will stay back. Next day it rained. Oh my goodness, it rained. Next day after that, Sunday morning, it rained. Oh my goodness, it rained. So we had a window of 1 hour to pick up our kids. And we had wanted to pick them up later after church service. At the time, it was during our normal hours. We had the three church services, and so it was during church, and so we didn't want people out of church, that this and that, you know. So, but we had this 1 hour during the third service to go pick up our kids, 11 to 12. And so we're frustrated, you know, so we race up there to get the kids. And we are hearing reports that there is a severe weather storm warning coming to our mountains right here, right where the kids are going to be. And so they're getting the kids, and everybody's picking up the kids, and we didn't realize what kind of camp they had. They had to change their entire camp. They had all these outdoor activities planned and hikes and zip line and this and that. They couldn't do any of that. They had to do indoor games because it was raining. Thankfully, the camp had this 1,200-person tent, so they were able to do games underneath that tent and have a good time and do praise and worship and go eat, and they spent a lot of time in their cabins talking the word and that sort of thing. They had a great camp. The kids did not know what it took for our children's ministry team to put that on. So we go up and we pick them all up, and the last kid gets picked up, and all of our staff comes down. And right after that, in a matter of 120 minutes, 9 inches of rain dumped right on that area. I've got a picture of what happened to that Christian camp up on the overheads. This is Forest Home Christian Camp. You see the van, the utility van, surrounded by mud and water and rock, and there's the tent that our kids were playing in. Notice I waited a year to tell you about this. I ain't sending my kids to no camp. But look at that. Today, they've restored everything. They've completely renovated. They've got everything back in order. But we were praying down here, all kinds of prayers. Short prayers, long prayers, fervent prayers, faith-filled prayers. Not one of our children was hurt. Not one of our children was lost. Praise the Lord. What's God speaking to you? Take a moment right now and just pray a simple prayer right where you're at. Maybe your prayer tonight is help. Maybe tonight your prayer is thank you. Maybe tonight your prayer is, God, you're good. Maybe tonight your prayer is, God, I need to be healed. Maybe tonight your prayer is provide. Just pray that simple prayer right now in faith, believing that God hears you. God's going to move on your behalf. Tonight in this holy moment, I feel like we just need to do this. Maybe tonight you've never said hello to the Lord. Maybe you never started this walk with God. And tonight you came in and you're new, or maybe you've been around church for a long time. You've prayed a lot of prayers, but it's been cold and dead religion. I want to talk to you about your eternal life because it's very important. It's the most important thing, the most important decision you're ever going to make while you're here on the earth. And contrary to what many people will tell you, not all roads lead to heaven. It's like saying all roads lead to the moon. It doesn't work like that. You can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you will never make it. There's only one way you're going to get there. In the same way, don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross, don't you think after he does all that, that he would tell us how to get to heaven? He does, right here in his word. Sometimes people think, well, that means that all I have to do is be good. And if I can be good enough, that will get me into heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you can be good enough to get to heaven? It doesn't work like that. You can't be good enough to get into heaven. Standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. Some of you might be thinking, well, you know, I get that, but I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Isn't that how we get to be Christians? Because we're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. I didn't check any other religions on the census. Therefore, I must be Christian, right? Because I'm not any other category. I'm a Christian nation, raised in church. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents tell you Christians growing up? You're raised in church, born in America, because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian. It's not about other people or society or your parents. This is just you and God. Take a moment right now and take inventory of your heart. What makes you think you're going to heaven? It's the most important question you'll ask yourself. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, I'm going to go to heaven because hell's not real. It's just a story that parents made up to scare their children into being good, isn't it? No. You know that's in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of it. And Jesus talking about it, it's real, guys. I don't want you to go there. You don't want you to go there. But most of all, God doesn't want you to go there. That's why he sent Jesus to the cross. Take the penalty for our sins so we didn't have to go to hell, but we could live with him forever. Some people think, well, I'm going to go to heaven because I attend church. I'm sitting in church in front of you right now, and I consider myself to be a Christian. But did you know that you can't just sit in a church service and call yourself a Christian? That makes you a Christian. It's like me saying, I want to be a fish. I'm going to go sit in a lake, call myself a fish, and I'll become a fish. It's like I sit there as long as I want. All I will become is a slimy human. Not going to make me a fish. Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. Some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, not only, you know, have I attended church, my last church I got involved, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions. People thought of me as a leader, got a membership card. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Show that to me in the Bible where that gets you into heaven. It's not there. Nowhere in the Bible to say your church involvement gets you to heaven or God's waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter. It doesn't work like that. You say, but Pastor, I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate the resurrection at Easter. Sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Old and New Testament. It's great. I'm glad you can do those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, could you? Everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is up here. But rather, this is about your heart. Have you given God all of your heart and all of your life? Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They raked it through the coals. Made it out to be something that it's not, some weirdo goofiness. No one wants to be a part of that. Listen, let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet describe for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart. And you've given God all of your life. That simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. We're talking about that earlier, right? Jesus comes and he's speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And that proves to me you can't just sit in church and call yourself a Christian because of what he says. He says, when I come, don't you know he's coming soon? He says, I better find you hot or I better find you cold because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Tonight, have you given him all of your heart? Have you given him all of your life? I'm going to ask everybody, please remain seated. Don't let anything distract you right now. This is your eternal destiny at stake. In a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, it's your call. It's your choice. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Or will you sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right? The opportunity looks like this. I'm going to count to three. One, two, three, and then pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands pop together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, want to give God all my life, want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that embarrassment tonight, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Come on, no one's that dumb. And yet the devil thinks that you are, but you're not, you're smart. You tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God tonight. Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. And listen, this is a safe and friendly church service. No one's criticizing, no one's judging, no one's laughing at you. We're excited. We want you to do this. We've all done it. One way or another, one time or another in our lives. Now it's your turn. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Who should raise their hand? You've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Come on, you can make a right relationship with Jesus, acknowledging your need for him by simply raising your hand. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, or online. You're ready to get your hand up. God sees and God's watching. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one. There's two. There's three. God bless you. Who else? There's four. Got you over there. There's five. Got you right up front. Thank you. Five wise people already. Anybody else real quick that I did not already? Six, seven. Got you over there. Thank you. Thank you. Up on top. Got you. Eight. Got you. Nine. Got you up there. Thank you. Nine wise people already. Can't you just feel number 10? Number 10, you're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah. You should. Go for it. Come on, if that's you. Raise your hand up high. Come on, where are you at? Number 10. God's speaking to your heart right now, tugging at your heartstrings, and you can feel that pull right now. If that's you, lift it up high for me. Anybody else, real quick? Come on, let's go. Let's go. Number 10, come on, where are you at? We're all waiting for you. Where are you at? Just pop it up high for me when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Okay, skip number 10. You missed it. Number 11, let's go. I'm just kidding. Anybody else, real quick? Let's go. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 9 wise people. Hallelujah. All right. All 9 of you and number 11. You should have raised your hand, but you didn't. At number 10, you can come too, you rascal. All right. Even if you didn't raise your hand, we want to give you an opportunity. We're all going to stand and sing a song as we do. We'll give you a clap and a shout. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to your church, a friend of you, your friend, get in the aisle and meet me up front. We're going to change destinies tonight. You come right now. If you raise your hand or you should have, just come on down. From the foyer, come on in. If that's you, you raise your hand or you should have, come on down. They're coming.
Give you my heart.
They're coming. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
I live for
from the family rooms, if you need to bring your children, bring them. They'll remember this.
Every
come on down right now.
That I change, every moment I'm away.
They're still coming.
Lord, have your
they're still coming.
Lord, I give my heart.
Hallelujah.
I give you my soul.
You can come. We'll wait for you.
I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away.
All right. Hey, whole lot more than 11 people up here. Praise the Lord. I'm so happy and so excited you guys came. Awesome. Let you in on a secret. My wife thinks that I'm blind and that I can't see. Okay? She thinks I can't count. I know I only counted 9 hands. So you guys must have came up and you didn't raise your hand. Or I'm blind. Okay. Either way, God is good. God is good. So excited for the new life that's ahead of you. You're going to give God all your heart, going to give God all of your life. Be brand new from the inside out. I want to introduce you to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel, real good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature, help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God. And then he'll introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, let me break it down for you like this. It's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. Then he'll let you come right back out. We've got some fun stuff going on tonight. So we invite you guys to hang out with the family here at The Rock. This is your new family. You're part of the family here. Okay? Is that neat? Welcome to the family of God. Now listen, make a promise. Give us a year, 1 year of your life here at The Rock Church World Outreach Center, consistently sitting under the teaching of the Word of God. If you can make it Sunday nights, come on. Make it Sunday mornings or Saturday morning, Wednesday night, Thursday morning for the women's Bible study. Maybe you can make it to the young adults ministry on Friday nights. Whatever you can get a hold of consistently for a year, get into church and apply the word that you hear. Like tonight, we talked about prayer. Just start praying. Start talking to God. He's going to lead you in your first prayer. It's awesome, okay? Then tomorrow when you wake up, you can say, good morning, God. Thank you for today, and start praying about your day. So as you do that, okay, after that year and on into the rest of your life, you will look around and you will say, oh my goodness, I did not know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? Okay, take their word for it, all right? You guys will make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give them a hand as they go. Woo! Love you, Pastor Joel.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.